service, today, we have, the territorial acknowledgement. I always jump around, you see, and so it just keeps these folks on their toes.
I keep up with you, I'm.
All right. So, read those, words, but it is, we are here, close neighbors with, the Wasonic people. And, it is incumbent upon us to be good neighbors and to interact in all ways that we can so that we understand together what it means to be good neighbors. And, as part of the United Church of Canada, we are always working towards reconciliation, for, to, heal the past and to together build a future, that is mutual and respectful. So there we are, and, we have celebrations, do we? And we have some announcements. Do we have celebrations?
46 years together, we've been trying to live in the same house.
You're in trouble now. Okay. We'll ask about that act. Any other celebrations? Okay. Any birthdays? All right. Well, we're kind of a dull group today, except for Al and Donna, but are we going to sing?
Sure.
Yeah.
Why not?
All right, we're going to sing our song.
Happy anniversary.
Happy anniversary
to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary, God bless you. Happy anniversary to you.
So, let's, put Al on the spot now, and, I asked him if he would just, come up, and tell us when might we think about being back in the building. I know curious minds always want to know that. Any idea about the addition, the new hall? But when might we get back into the church?
I don't know. Churches, or the addition is going well. We expect to be in there probably in September, in the addition. As far as the church is concerned, we are waiting for BC Hydro to do the connection to, because we only have a 100 amp service in there right now, and we need a 400 amp service before we can do anything. So, hopefully, at the end of August, or July, maybe even. All depends on when they come. And they've been, the work order has been signed about April. April. And so, we don't know.
Yeah, the Hydro actually came and looked, and was standing around looking at the telephone poles and the wires, so there's progress.
Well, there is. They know what pole they're coming down, they know how they're doing it, but to get them to do it,
you gotta take that pole down that's right at the drive corner of the driveway so people can get in here easier?
No.
None of that.
Thank you, Al, for all your hard work.
Yes, this is a tremendous gift of expertise and even keelness in his personality that Al is giving here, and Heather's also very involved, and I know they don't let Lisa do exactly building things, they just let her come in and sign checks and do all that. So anyway, it's a wonderful project that's happening, and it's happening just going ahead. Check out the webpage if you will, because the pictures on there. got it from, there's, I think, just about a weekly picture has been taken, and it's, and it floats, floats through, and you can really see the progress that's happening through there. Announcements, you know what, this week, this Friday is Centering Prayer. If you want to come for Centering Prayer, it's a beautiful experience, and we sit, have a little service and sit in silence together for about 20 minutes, and it's just revitalizing. So if you are interested in that, by all means come. Now, it's a commitment of this congregation to think about how we participate in the work of the wider United Church. And so you'll notice for the past few Sundays when I've been here that we always have a what we used to call a minute per mission. The story from the Mission and Service Fund, which is the national fund that all of us participate in through the church. Oh, look it.
You're
good.
No, I get you. Good guidance.
We changed the position of this, but our AV people right on, okay? So I'm going to call on Bree to come forward and to tell us about one of the ways or a project that we are participating in through our giving to mission service.
Life-changing art programs for children, and this was published on May 24th, just of this year, 2024. As you can see, there's children there, they're at a microphone, and they're making announcements. And what I like is that they taught us that we must make peace. These are the children's recorded programming through CPALC, which is an acronym for a very long name, which I will get to in through the course of this meeting of this particular project. For hundreds of children living in Cordoba, Colombia, arts programs supported through your mission and service gifts teach children about their rights, give them an opportunity to express themselves, and promote peacemaking as well as gender justice. Providing workshops for children that teach them about their rights empowers them to think critically about themselves and their country. Through media, art, music, and theater, they learn about important social issues, human rights, and gender equality. End of quote. Says the Latin American Center for Popular Communication. Children and the Latin American Center for Popular Communication, that's the acronym CEPALC, C-E-P-A-L-C, I guess that's the way they say it, CEPALC. Children are the most vulnerable group in Colombia. 84% of violent acts in Colombia are committed against children. 2.5 million children living there work to sustain their families. Many are forced into dangerous labor. That's why CPALC designs programs in sectors hardest hit by poverty and violence. Quote, I told my mother that we had seen some workers of Mahatma Gandhi, Nelson Mandela, and Flora Tristan. I remember that they taught us that we must defend the rights of us women. That what I like in general is that they taught us what we must do. And the Earl, who lives in Bogota and is a workshop participant. Quote, thanks to CPALC workshops, I'm a writer, and I write things so that children will promote and defend peace, following Jesus' example. I will defend and promote our rights in my stories so that nobody can disrespect us or the rights that we have. When I am an adult, I won't be doing violence against anybody. So there's a very
know what time it is, because the last two Sundays I've been here, I've gone vastly over time, and I'm not going to do it this week. So that's my commitment. Now then, let's take a breath, and let's light our candle here. Let's do our liturgy, but let's know that the light of Christ kindles our own light, and that during the service we hope there will be some ways that it will feel to you like your light is rekindled and is burning brightly, and that you feel the warmth of the love of God. Friends, the light is all around us.
Sign of the summer season.
Now let us light and receive the light of Christ.
Thanks be to Creator for fire and sun, for flame and symbol, for Christ's light and warmth.
And we have a very special music team today. Michael got called away. His mom-in-law is quite ill, and so he got called away on quite short notice. And so people have been working really hard, and so the music is going to be just every bit as good as what you add to it. Okay. So there's an all-out effort, but with leadership from our singing, from our musical leaders here. Our first hymn, Over My Head.
So we have some of our choir members here, and Don is sitting at the meeting. And we're going to sing with gusto, and we're going to show Michael when he comes back that we're the singers, the singers and the minister, all of us. Okay, all the lyrics are on the projector.
Somewhere.
text Michael and say, take as long as he.
Now don't make him feel bad.
Folks, will you join me in the responsive call to worship and opening prayer? Jesus became the talk of the town.
And was highly criticized when he ate with and talked to those considered unclean and unacceptable.
Acceptance, generosity, sharing a meal, understanding each other, those are the actions that defined what Jesus was all about.
Acceptance, generosity, sharing a meal, understanding each other.
The early church shaped their life together around these spiritual practices.
Acceptance, generosity, sharing a meal, understanding each other. May these words define our life together as a congregation and the way each of us lives and works in the world.
Our theme time today is Jackie, the puppet, wanted to come, but she was torn because she wanted to go to the Pride Parade too. So I think she's off marching in the heat. So I wanted to ask you, because the scripture reading is going to be the one about, you know, Jesus goes back to his hometown and he's not received very well there because they say, isn't that Joel's boy? You know, why is he talking like that? He's really got kind of uppity. So I wondered, how many of you no longer live in your hometown, the place where you were children? Okay. So people who grow up in a certain area and become adults, people's experience of that person grows up with them, right? So there's a point where if you were little Barbara here, but then they've experienced you throughout your life and they've let you grow up. But when you go and leave your hometown after high school or something, that's where people's experience of you ends. And so I wondered, have you ever had any experience of going back to your hometown as an adult and finding that people really misinterpreted you or misunderstood you? Or like, for example, when I go back to Fergus, my hometown, if I happen to see this one person, they talk about, they say, oh, I remember you, Cheryl. You were the back catcher, and we were playing against you for the championship of the Grand River Ball Tournament, and you were the catcher, and you overthrew second base, and we won the game. Do you remember that, Cheryl?
No.
Right? So, I've not changed a bit from that person who overthrew second base. You know, even though in my own mind, I have changed. Have you got experiences like that when you've gone back to your hometown and their experience of you or their memory of you just didn't match where you were at? Anybody?
Yeah, after going back after 40 years, when I was in the car with my nephew, and he stopped in the middle of the wall, and I said, you can drive through, I've seen it. And he said, no. And Chris said, there is a stop sign now.
Okay.
There never was a stop sign in that village.
Okay. So the village, you had to experience the village changing.
Yeah.
Yep. So think about that, and we don't have to belabor it, you may find, as Jesus did, that there are disconnects. So just think about those and think about what that does to our, how you handle that. Because this is what Jesus is going to be doing. He's got a handle going back to his hometown and being misjudged there. Okay, so that's your story. Let's have our bell and then just have some music for meditation. Special music.
Synagogue. Many people were there, and when they heard him, they were all amazed. what mission is this that has been given him? How does he perform miracles? Isn't he the carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? Aren't his sisters living here? And so they rejected him. Jesus said to them, a prophet is respected everywhere except in his own hometown and by his relatives and his family. He was not able to perform any miracles there, except that he placed his hands on a few sick people and healed them. He was greatly surprised because the people did not have faith. Jesus sends out the 12 disciples. Then Jesus went to the villages around there, teaching the people. He called the 12 disciples together and sent them out two by two. He gave them authority over the evil spirits and ordered them, don't take anything with you on the trip except the walking stick, no bread, no beggar's bag, no money in your pockets. Wear sandals, but don't carry an extra shirt. He also told them, wherever you are welcome, stay, and in the same house until you leave that place. If you come to a town where people do not welcome you or will not listen to you, leave it and shake the dust off your feet. That will be a warning to them. So the disciples went out and preached that people should turn away from their sins. They drove out many demons and rubbed olive oil on many sick people and healed them. I have to say, I have never returned to my hometown.
So folks, I know that Alan really celebrated Pride a couple of weeks ago and led that service, so we're not particularly focusing on Pride today, although we do realize it's Pride Sunday in this area, and there's the Pride Parade is going on in Victoria. But the illustrations I'll use will probably be Pride illustrations, but we'll try to kind of hear what this scripture reading has to say. So I want to begin with a story that I heard. There was a former Army drill sergeant who took a new job as a school teacher. But just before the school year began, he injured his back quite badly, and he was required to wear a plaster cast around the upper part of his body. Fortunately, that cast fit under his shirt and it wasn't noticeable at all. So on the first day of school, he found himself assigned to the toughest students in the school. The smart alecky punks who'd already heard that the new teacher was a former drill sergeant, and they were a bit leery of him. How's this gonna go? They decided to see how tough he was before they got up to any pranks. So he walked confidently that first day into the rowdy classroom, and he went over and he opened up the window wide and he sat down at his desk. When a strong breeze came in, it made his tie flap in the wind. But he picked up the stapler and he promptly stapled the tie to his chest. He had no trouble whatsoever with discipline that year. So a stranger gets to make a first impression, don't they? And he set the tone of his interactions, because nobody knew him before except by adult reputation. Not so with he talks really good, doesn't he, to taking offense? Who does he think he is? How did he come to think he's any better than we are? And so some of the folks, and I'm sure it wasn't a unanimous experience, but some of the folks there decided that they would be offended by Jesus and that they would judge him based on who he had been as a kid, who his brothers and sisters were, and what place his family had in the community. So Jesus discovered that there are people who are quite closed-minded. They won't let their minds or their information be updated. They get their opinion is based on old experiences, old information, and they're intransient about changing their minds or letting new information in. And the scripture tells us that Jesus is amazed. They can't see him for who he is now, for the way he's developed. They can only see who he used to be. Went to a film this week at Broadview. They were having a Pride Film Fest, and the third film that they had was called Dawn, D-A-W-N, Her Dad and the Tractor. And it was the story of a young trans woman who is returning to the family farm, someplace around, it sounded like Halifax, in the Maritimes. And she was going to see her father and her sister for the first time since she has transitioned. And so we hear in the movie always the sister wanting to know, where is Don, D-O-N. Why isn't he showing up? And their mother always said, well, she kept in touch with Dawn. But the sister was really annoyed that Dawn didn't keep in touch with father or with her. So then Dawn, D-A-W-N, comes to the door. And she doesn't know, should she rap on the family home or should she just walk in? Because she is no longer the same person. And neither her sister nor her father know anything about this, although her mother was supportive all throughout her journey of transition. And so the movie is, the film is an excellent one, about a sister and a father learning that love is greater than these changes. And the story is the unfolding of the acceptance in the family for Dawn, D-A-W-N. And it happens around a tractor. But there are others in the community. Some are supportive, but there are others who are offended. And they give offense. And her life, her days as she waits for her mother's funeral,
not everyone will change their mind. Not everyone is able or willing to open to this new dawn. And so Dawn works with the people she can and tries to avoid the bullies who want to make a point. It's a great movie. I have to say to you, while I was watching it, I thought, you know, I can really see, and somebody had suggested, that when the new hall comes into being, that we'll be able to have films and movies, maybe even monthly, just as a regular kind of thing. And it would be movies not only for entertainment, although getting into a good story is great, but movies and films that help us grow in empathy and in understanding. That would be a great thing to put into how we're going to use the new hall. Anyway, in the movie, after Dawn's father starts to talk to her again and sees how some particular people are just being intransient, he says to Dawn, and this is the first hint that his heart is open and warming, he says to Dawn that the intransient one is a coward, but she is not. And it becomes clear that you can't change everybody. Well, you can't really change anybody, but no, some people will not change because they're just too close-minded, they're too insecure, whatever their reason is. And that's what Jesus found in this story. There could be very little healing, there could be very little teaching. For the people, there could be no positive energy exchange, no learning with the people whose minds were closed, with the people whose attitude was set by past experiences, by a person who believed they no longer had to take in new information or be willing to learn. But the thing with Jesus is, he saw this, and rather than feeling like, you know, I should try harder with these people, he moves on to the next village. Because he understands that what he has to offer is a precious gift. And for those who will not see, will not be open, will not learn about, will not receive this precious gift, well, he can't let that derail his mission to offer it to as many people as possible. How many of you have wasted precious time in your lives trying to argue with closed-minded people? You know, how many of you have seen and really encountered people who don't want to hear any new information?
Yeah.
And if you're like me, sometimes you keep thinking, well, if I could only give a better argument, if I could just make it plainer, if I could throw myself somehow so that they would understand the struggle.
cannot make someone be empathetic. That is their work to do. And so Jesus gives us a model of offering his gifts, offering his teachings, offering his healing engagement. And when it's rejected, the scripture tells us there was a few. And so he interacted with those few. Then he moved on to the next town. And he wasn't taken aback or anything by what happened. In fact, this next story tells us that he expanded his ministry. He moved on, and he says to the disciples, there's so many people here who want this healing, who want to experience what a changed life could be for them. There's too many for me to deal with. I'm going to send you out two by two to bring healing love into people's lives, to bring the story of the change that is possible, both in our society and in you as individuals. And so he organizes the disciples to go out two by two. It's true, eh? We're always stronger together. If you want really something to happen, send two people. They can support one another. And what Jesus is teaching is trust the receptivity of those you will meet. Don't take anything with you. Throw yourself on the hospitality of the people where you are. Now, in that day and age, people did invite folks into their homes. They invited folks to meals. So it was part of the hospitality code that they lived with. But if someone will not offer you the hospitality of their home, of their food, of their open mind, of their willing heart, if they will not give you a receptive mind, move on. I think about the Pride Parade going on, and it's amazing, eh? Now it's become the place to be, right? Anybody who's anybody is going to be at the parade. Do you remember when the first Pride Parade happened here in Vancouver? Probably the first one in Canada happened in Vancouver. And there was lots of opposition. Was tremendously opposed. And if you go on Pride Canada and read the website about the history of what's happened and how it is that Pride went from being a courageous few to becoming a movement that let people move out in power and hope, to becoming what it is today, the place to be. And you see, Jesus told the disciples, tells us, I think, still today, the mission of love, the mission of helping to heal one another, the mission of learning to change, to open our minds to new ways and to new experiences. That mission is too important. And there are too many in this world who want it for us to waste. with those who will not receive. I think that is the mission for our small, strong, sustainable little churches today, spiritually alive ones. It is to find the allies who want to expand the love and the hope and the openness of our communities. That's what we're about. And instead of telling the stories of, well, you should have heard how negative this person was, we need to refocus ourselves and tell the story of how positive this one was. How willing the majority have been to make changes, to let love shape the agenda. Well, that's all I got for today, and we're going to be in good time, folks. So thank you very much for listening. And our hymn is Make Me a Channel of Your Peace. And as we sing it, let's all think about ourselves being a channel of peace and healing.
This is a beautiful song. In the footnotes of our hymn book, it states that the words were attributed to St. Francis in 1220. So sing the song with love and peace in your heart.
It's that time in the service when we invite the offering, and I always think with the offering that so many of you have already made it. You've already made it through PAR. You've already made it in the offering plate as you came in the door. If you haven't yet, it'll be there on your way out. You've also made your offering in the way you've lived this past week. We have people probably from this congregation who are down making their offering at the Pride Parade and carrying the Central Sanish United Church banner. We have people who throughout the non-Sunday we also take this opportunity to say thank you. Thank you for all that you do. Thank you for the ways that you give so generously of yourselves to others in your lives. Our sum dedication is, grant us God the grace. Did we say one verse or did we say it all? One verse. Good. Grant us God the grace of giving. Continue opening our hearts in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we bring before you the prayers of all our hearts. We pray for all those who gather in downtown Victoria to march in the Pride Parade. We pray also for those people who are unable to be in the Pride Parade but wish they could be. We pray for all those who have experienced the discrimination of not being welcome in our community. And we pray that your healing love will touch all the hearts that are necessary so that all might find acceptance and hope and love in this community. Gracious God, we pray for ourselves and for our families. Some of us carry deep worries about our families and for ourselves. And so we pray, gracious God, that through this community of love and hope, that we will be reminded we are not alone and that we have people who care about us and we can talk to and receive support as we go through times that are difficult. And we pray where possible, gracious God, for the healing of those we love and our own healing, that that we might be and find the peace that is your gift to us. Gracious God, for the world we live in and all the changes that seem to be taking place, we pray and we open our hearts and we ask that somehow your spirit will influence and motivate and change people's hearts and minds so that they are more centered on peace than on war, more centered on sharing than on having for themselves, more focused on being a loving community than on hating your neighbor. Gracious God, hear our prayers and hear us as we continue to pray in unison the prayer of Jesus. Our Mother.